So basically the way this is going to go, I think, is that we're going to go for about an hour. Oh yeah, is someone willing to be a timekeeper?
Oh, I can't find the clock.
Because I'm terrible at doing that.
What's the schedule?
So I want us to like go for about 45 minutes. So I've come with some questions, but I hope we'll just have sort of an organic conversation with these guys about their amazing show. And see where the conversation leads. And it's such a small group, we can, even though we're kind of set up in this formal way, I feel like we can have this be really informal. I want you to feel free to join in the conversation. So if you have questions for these guys or something that is being said sparks an idea that you have, please speak up or raise your hand or something to get in here. That'd be really awesome. But then also at the end of the time, we'll have time to. Let's interrupt while we're talking. So I'm going to do a short introduction, and then we'll just go right into discussion. Oh, and before that, though, the first thing I wanted to say is I just wanted to take a moment to sort of acknowledge that this is we're witnessing something really exciting here, which is the beginning of a new Artist Friend exhibition space, which I think has incredible potential to do some really exciting things here. And so I feel like we can make a toast to the specialists into the future. Yeah. Yes. Yay. Okay, so I was really excited when these guys asked me to moderate this because I'm really a fan of both of these guys' work, and it was really fun for me to think about to think about their work and think of questions, think about this show, which I love. So by way of introduction, I'm not gonna do a very formal introduction where I tell you where they've shown and stuff, but more I'm gonna tell you what I've seen of their work and what I think about it, and why I get excited about it. So let's start with Will. So Will, I met a few years ago when he invited me to come meet him at the show. That was at Glassbox Gallery. Did anyone else here see that show? You missed it.
I don't remember where they all were.
So yeah, this one is down at the, pretty close by this one, the other side of the International District in that glass sort of modernist gallery. Anyway. So it was a show, so I didn't really know Will or much about his work before then, but it was a show that really impressed and excited me, and it was called Very American Salad, is that right? Mm-hmm. Was the title of the show, and he walked up into a space, and it was a work that looks really different than the work that's here. It was, the sort of main element was a series of flags that were constructed using found textiles, mostly it seemed like blankets, like kind of commercially printed blankets or tea towels, and they all kind of took the form of the American flag very broadly, so like a large rectangle with a smaller rectangle in the upper left corner. Is that the American flag? Yeah. And they were funny. They were funny, and they were sweet, and they were kind of confusing, and they were all suspended or sort of placed in space using a pretty elaborate system of bungee cords that were anchored by different kinds of household objects. And then there were other elements in that show that I remember that are also really intriguing, these sort of things that look like 3D printed navy sculptures of like corporate logos, but they actually were handmade with glue gun. Sort of building up letters, and there were some photographs in that show as well, I think, that also had to do with sort of thinking about packaging and advertising from a really, from a perspective that I hadn't ever seen before, that seemed actually very sweet and loving, and unusual in a context where often in contemporary advertising and corporate culture is looked at through a super critical lens. So that was my first experience of Will's work and got me really excited about it. I also then looked him up, of course, online, and came across the series of work that he did of photographs, and it seemed like originally you were a photographer, kind of from that photography background. And these were photographs called Commercial Core, and there was a series of books that collected them, and they were all photographs taken in downtown Seattle. And they're very, I just recommend looking them up if you haven't seen them, because they capture something about Seattle that that feels really, feels really true and well observed and kind of surprising. So that's my introduction to Will. Alexi, I also met a few years ago when a mutual artist friend introduced us at an opening, and he invited me over for a studio visit, which is the first time I saw his work. And he works out of a room in his home, which is smaller than this space and was jammed full of an incredible amount of work. It was really impressive to me. It was sort of like the situation where you walk in and there's like stacks of canvases stacked up against each other, and you feel like you could spend, you feel like you found like Aladdin's treasure cave or something. I felt that way. You could spend, days in there uncovering treasures. And the paintings that he was doing at that time when I saw it seemed really related to the work that's in this show. Sort of gestural, beautiful, but also like kind of elusive in their meaning or what they're actually representing. And then when I Googled Alexi after that visit and looked at some of his older work, the work that was most striking to me was something he was doing, I don't know, like 5 or 10 years ago, that were these paintings of dogs that seemed like kind of a strange like genre painting, that style that he had made up himself, because it was sort of like dog painting or dog portrait painting, but it was like images of dogs giving birth to other dogs, a dog giving birth to a puppy. There was also a really interesting looking painting that to me felt a lot like if you can imagine like a cross between like Van Gogh's Potato Eaters with like velvet painting of dogs from Hooker. I think that would give you an idea of sort of the like kind of way the paintings were being made, but like the tenderness and intensity with which he was painting these really surprising scenes. So that work looks really different than this work. So one thing I want to talk about is the evolution from that point. Alexi. The only other thing I wanted to say, this actually turns into an elaborate introduction. You can tell I'm excited about this guy's work. So the other thing I wanted to say about Alexi's work now is I feel like he paints like an old man, which is something that's like really, I mean, I think in painting, like there's this idea that painters only get better as they get older, which is something I've always, as a painter myself, like an idea I've always held on to. And I think the reason that sort of happens sometimes is that there's something about painting where increasingly, if you do it over a long period of time, you kind of give less and less of a shit about a lot of things that you start out really caring about, like the burden of a painting's history, of all the things that you think you should be doing or you could be doing with it. Like those things, if you really keep up a painting practice, they slowly start leaving, and you start making paintings that are that have this sort of immediateness and kind of freshness and kind of intensity that I think only comes through a really long period of actually doing the work of painting. And I feel like Alexi, with the work that's here, has kind of reached that point prematurely or earlier than I think a lot of painters do, which I think is something that's really exciting to see and interesting. Okay, enough of me talking. That's the most, hopefully, I'm going to talk this whole time. So questions for you guys to start us off. Maybe we'll start with you, Alexi. So one thing I wanted to have you do is see if you could imagine that you were talking to all of us on like the phone, like this was like a conference call or something, but we couldn't see your paintings. And I wanted you to just describe them to us.
Okay. So, I just have to kind of just give words of what they look like. of plants and buildings and numbers, letters, maybe some faces, maybe some parts. And there's a Mickey Mouse in there somewhere. There's some palm trees, apple.
What's your routine for painting, or what's your,
I find that it works the best if I have a lot of prep. So if I have all the paints ready, and these paints, they're all, you know, they're oil paint out of the tube, and they're mixed with different things. And the way that I apply them is really, like, viscous, sort of liquidy. Really thin down, and I kind of have to have a lot of paint available to make it go on the paper in that way. And so I have to have everything ready because it's not really ready. It's like the painting happens kind of too slowly. So I'll have like, you know, 10 colors out there in jars. You know, all day. Like literally sometimes it's like half a day I'm just like mixing up these jars. And I'll be sitting there and I work on the floor because I have to make them flat, like, because the paint can just like drip off on the wall. And so it's like me sitting on the floor in this kind of concrete slab in the room, and I'm just like painting on these pieces of paper. And there's typically like a lot of, there's like a whole wall in front of me of other paintings that I made maybe like a week or the past few weeks before that. So I'm using those as like a reference, and maybe like whole stacks of drawings that are more like marker drawings, and those are also references, and so I'm kind of like mix some of those around, and you know, get images out of those. So that's what happens.
Yeah. Are you working on more than one at the same time?
Yeah, so there'll be like maybe three of them. Some of them are like kind of just one visit, you know, but maybe they're made one in one session, and then some of them will have like maybe two or three sessions. I mean, you typically what happens is it'll be like on a Saturday or a Sunday, and I'll wake up and I'll make like 10 paintings and throw a bunch of them away, or like 30 that are sort of keeping.
You paint on the ground.
It's really liquid paint. Uh-huh. It's literally like the oil. It's like oil paint, but it feels like watercolor. So okay. If it was on a flat thing, if it was on a wall, just
what is drip off the pigment that makes it so liquid, or the material?
The medium is a combination of. There's a couple different ones, but it's basically just like a stand oil and a turpentine, where it's like a Utrecht oil painting medium that's like pre-bottled. Or it's a cold wax medium that's been like melted down with turpentine. So it really is like a liquidy cold wax medium.
So it sounds like in terms of the imagery or shapes, like it's sort of like a iterative process where you're looking at things you've made before or drawings you've made and recycling. Is there like where does into that sort of, like I imagine, like a sort of circular system where the feedback loop basically. But is there a point at which something like new imagery or shapes enter into it? And how does that work?
I think so. And so the way that the new maybe some new shapes might get in there is through much more simple drawing certain times. And so, you know, while I see through sketchbooks or lots of little pieces of paper and lots of little drawings, and just put those aside and come back to another stack of paper later and make a whole bunch more drawings. And so I think in those sort of doing lots of drawings, some new pictures come in. And, you know, sometimes I'm just kind of like, man, simple, anyway. So whatever that shape was, or simple, or whatever. And so I'll kind of try to push it away and create some new ones.
When you go to do that, the editing kind of process you described, where you make a bench and then pull some away, what do you, like, how do you, can you articulate the criteria for the successful ones? Like, do you know what
The drawings that are like actual like in the drawing stage where it's more like to kind of coming up with the composition and sort of image materials in that drawing stage, it's pretty like at this point it feels like automatic drawing. I'm just kind of like, you know, I'm drawing this some images or some shapes, or I'm drawing like, I don't know, for example, like a little Mickey Mouse head, there's a photo where Mickey Mouse head is popping up off of that. It actually, the drawings, they look very like cartoon, like they look like probably like cartoon sort of. They're just like one line and then like so those ones, it's kind of like I know right away if I like it. But then I think those ones are basically what happens is the paint's really hard to get to look the way that I want it to look. So also, I'm just getting kind of scrapped. And it's just, I have all this material, all these little drawings and stuff, so I'm really just kind of like, can I get the drawings onto the piece of painting surface with paint and still have to do the same thing? So every once in a while, that happens. Or still have to do the same kind of thing compositionally, but in the paint, it looks, it has much more interesting surfaces or colors.
So there was something in the press release for the show that intrigued me where, I'm not sure exactly who wrote it, but it was talking about these paintings in relation to community theater posters, community theater production posters, which I thought was really interesting, and I wondered, yeah, what's the connection?
I think I wrote it because I was just kind of looking at all the paintings and kind of like, huh, how would I describe these things? And they look like posters kind of. They look like, I think they remind me of posters from like the 60s. That's what I was imagining, like the 60s poster for The Great Gatsby in like Long Island or something at a community theater. Like somebody, some person just was like, oh, you know, painted like an ink drawing and that was their poster for the production. That's what something about the look of these and like the handling of the paint or the gesture was something like that, I guess.
Is there something about that? I mean, in my mind immediately went to like amateur art expressions.
Yeah.
Is there something about that with the community theater connection?
Yes. I mean, yeah, definitely. Like in the fact that it's on paper and it's like, you know, like when I think of like community theater paintings, they're made like not, you know, I imagine that they're made not with like well expensive oil paints made, like what do they have? Like temperas, and then they're just kind of like soft around and you're just trying to get a message across. So yeah. Also, probably like I would say in my sort of appreciation of art and growth, I think like lots of people of our generation, Mike Kelly slipped in there at some point and just sort of stepped around. He did a heck of a lot of kind of appropriations of sort of amateur art of all kinds. And so I think a lot of people of our generation were pretty influenced by that as well.
I actually
want to
add, I'm going to start with stupidity, because I feel like I've read some things you've written that talk about stupid objects or that, like, you seem like you're interested in stupidness. And I was wondering if you'd say more about it, why and what that means.
I think, especially with this is a good example, just making stuff in very immediate ways that are ignoring common sense a lot of the time. Just very, I mean, just making like physical objects, like I've been making lately, just doing it in the most immediate and kind of dumb way that is only focused on the goal with zero consideration for longevity or even the end result beyond like exactly what the idea is while you're doing it. You know, like never at all stepping back and being like, but if I do it like this, here's all the problems I will face. Just sort of like pinpoint, just do it exactly one way with zero consideration of all of the mistakes you're making as you go. Like this in particular, when I was considering putting this in here, I remade the whole thing with white wood, with just like, you know, regular 2x4s, not pressure treated, because I thought lighter might look better in here. And it was so much better constructed because it was a remake of a thing I'd already made, that it was just, it's like annoying, it's like too well built. It was like annoyingly good. Whereas like the problems of this one are so much better looking to me, like more attractive to me in the end. Because it's just dumb. Like it doesn't, the way it's made does not make sense. And I like that, just kind of minimal planning, I guess. Or just sort of like sketch, like, because I do a lot of sketching and, you know, planning in that way for physical objects, but then as far as realizing them in their final form, more just going straight from the drawing versus stepping back and like considering how that would actually work. Just like, no, it'll work, it's fine. Not like over planning.
Yeah, that's the same thing of like vulnerability, like it's sort of a quality that comes through with this, as opposed to the one that maybe you remade, you know, where you were more certain, like
right.
There's something vulnerable about showing us the this process of not knowing what you're doing, or does that sound?
No, I think that's a big part of it, is like making the errors very clear. Like the errors and mistakes, and I guess things I didn't see that by just doing it without stepping back and going forward and one thing, boom, boom, it's done. And then just like leaving on display all of the things that went wrong. Is that what you're thinking?
Yeah.
And I like that. Like the problems are sort of the most important part. Everything about that is pretty problematic and looks like it will.
So when you said earlier that you like you have the goal, and you know, and then sort of the process is sort of like trying to, you know, to make it in a way that you're not overthinking, maybe, or not saying exactly when you said it, but so what's the, like in a piece like this specifically, like what was the goal, like when you started?
It was like I had just drawn like a pretty general, I mean it relates a lot to what I had drawn, but it was kind of that thing. And it was also my basement studio is pretty rough, and so I had like taken out a lot of the drywall, and so it was like an idea to make this thing we could lean against the wall and just get screwed into like the existing stuff that were already exposed, which I didn't do here because it didn't seem necessary.
So this is just props.
Yes, just leaning.
There are some people like that too.
I've never actually heard you talk about it,
right.
So it's very exciting for me. But I, the thing that you described about the problems and the errors is really interesting to me, because that seems like, as someone who is a perfectionist, and I am a project manager, and you know, I am always about making things, trying to make them really great and perfect, right? On time, on budget, all of these things, right? And so I feel like what you're trying to do is very much swimming upstream, like culturally, because I feel like we're very much about trying to make things great and perfect.
Right.
And is that hard? Are you like fighting against any sort of, you know, or is it your nature to like do this, right?
I guess. I don't know if it's my nature, but I think I just have a big appreciation for like weird Jimmy Riggs shit. Like anytime I see stuff where it's like, I'm trying to think of a really good example. It's just like, there's the one Thai restaurant that's right by like the Mount Baker train station. And it's walked to Veronica's, this other gallery, like through the alley. They had this shipping container that was just like permanent storage. It's always there. And one end of it, it was like, one end was on the ground, like sort of behind the building, then it stuck out into the parking lot. And the two corners, it was like on a grade, so the two corners of it stuck out pretty far. And they were just on like the sketchiest, like three cinder blocks and like a bunch of shims and just like, whatever was available when it like got put there, and they're like, well, we gotta make it even, let's see what we can do, it'll be fine. Just like shored up however they could. And then that was good enough and lasted for till now. It's still going. Just stuff like that I really, really like. And it's funny to try and recreate that like from new. And you kinda have to like go fast to ignore a lot of stuff, but just, you know, that's kind of the big inspiration, is just like making things work when they really shouldn't.
Did you ever, oh, sorry.
So, I'm curious about this piece because when I look at it before, it's always been the foam as an afterthought, mm-hmm. and the last piece, and now when I'm looking at it today, I'm like, well, why do I think that cement is the actual piece and everything else comes off of it, and so I'm curious about that, because now I can see the cement piece as the last part of the puzzle.
Right. Well, it was made to fit it. The cement piece was kind of first. The rest of it was built to support it.
Uh-huh.
But the foam was kind of last. It was part of the plan, but definitely was the last thing that happened.
Uh-huh. It looks like a life jackets me, or
floaty
thing.
Oh my gosh, they're floaties,
they're
like
whatever. Oh yeah,
I guess I have a question about when you saw that piece in the alley, are there any, like, compared to that scenery that is in the alley compared to the white walls in the gallery, do you ever want to like, interact with those environments, or do you want to like strictly bring those like things and condense them into the gallery?
I think I'm more interested, like gallery or out in the world, I'm more interested in just like that way of making stuff. Like that sort of just, I don't have good words to describe exactly what it is, but that way of sort of like doing whatever you can in the moment and then being good enough. And it's like also a very creative thing where it's just like figuring out how to make it fine.
Improvising?
Yeah, it's just improvisation, yeah.
Does it ever feel like comical when you're making it to yourself? You're like kind of doing it.
Yeah, no, I think it's always really funny.
Like, like that's kind of the joy that I get from looking at it. It's kind of like it's kind of comedy in a way, or like fun. Mm-hmm. Like you know how much fun it was to make, and
right.
How like you're just making. I can just picture you making it here, basically just having a great time, kind of feeling.
Right.
Kind of relaxing.
I think that like describing it as dumb. I think that's a big part of that. Just like it's not. There's no right or wrong. It's just a really loose. Yeah.
Okay, just in terms of time, maybe we can go back to a couple, finish off with a couple of your questions and then open it back up.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
sure.
We're already. Wow. Oh, wait. We started later. We have like 10 to 15 more minutes.
Okay. Okay, thanks.
Matt.
Just flying by.
I know, it is. Yeah. I feel like there's so much talk to have here. But okay. Okay, so one thing I wanted to ask both of you about I feel like, well, something that I've been thinking a lot about in my work is identity politics, I guess, or like sort of being a straight white guy during a time in the country where, like Roberta Smith in the New York Times on Friday, called this moment like the sort of what's happening in national. I think it was a review of the Kara Walker show. This is the Kara Walker show, but it's like the moment of like the death rattle for white male power in this country is what we're experiencing right now. And I guess I wonder if you guys if thinking about like power, privilege, and identity, like if there's something that plays into your work, it connects with how you think about what you do in your realm.
I guess this step is sort of a departure because it's less exercise related, but the stuff like what moved me into like the materials I'm making now is much more based around like weights and exercise. And it was not, not so much thinking about my personal identity, but just an idea of like strength and feeling good for everyone. Just like, it's really funny, but like, or not funny, but corny, I guess. Like, the power of exercise in the most literal terms, just like everyone's personal ability to feel very good if they so choose. I guess that's not really.
Outside of painting, I work in construction, so
do you feel like the gender ambiguity or sort of or non-genderedness of your painting, is that something deliberate, or you think that's just a sort of it's something you see in it, but it's not something that you like try to put in there?
I don't think it's something I try to put in there, but I would say it's a reflection of myself. Yeah, I mean, I have a game that is could go either way. I don't feel like my personality is particularly like masculine, I guess. So I think that maybe ambiguity is just a result of who I am as a person.
It's funny you say that, because I find that work you guys do outside of this can be easily supposed as being masculine or very industrial. And almost what's in like antithetical about your work is that you're doing something that is similar and kind of brings out the industrialness a little bit, not in a full sense, but partially. There's a reminiscent imagery, or the way materials are working, or the way you're talking about it, is like bringing something out of daily life, but not that either. There's no imagery of that left after you're done with it. There's either concrete here, there are leftover remnants of something, but they're not exactly that either. They're leftover posters, probably, but they're not that either. So then, almost pushing for the uncanny kind of feeling of dealing with it, what you're experiencing daily, and just passing by those experiences and just kind of is consciously working with that. And that's what I'm getting out of this. It's like it's reminiscent of school, it's reminiscent of posters or a sound that, once been there in the playground somewhere. And without trying to echo it, we end up there as a group. That's just like whatever it is, not just gender but identity politics, it's like what it seems like it is, it's never it is, but it's just kind of end up at that conclusion of experiencing something.
So it's like not just like gender ambiguity, but like ambiguity across lots of different categories in terms of identity, but also like what is this?
Identity of the thing
itself, right? Or in Alexei's work, like this, very clearly ambiguous imagery in the terms of being really hard for us to be specific stories, like there's either many stories we read into them or no stories at all.
Originally, it's really tricky because it is, it's abstraction. You both are doing abstraction, and so it's really easy to have that kind of open-ended thing go on. And I think there's a lot about the body, and there's a lot about the language that's being played with in a very open-ended way, which I really like. But then to say that the ambiguity creates that enough openness to say, oh, I'm engaging with the identity politics is really, I think it's true and dangerous at the same time.
Yeah, I don't know. I wouldn't like plan to engaging with any of that. I don't feel that I could claim that I'm actively engaging in that.
But you are actively participating in kind of this aesthetic ecosystem.
Oh yeah, absolutely, absolutely. I guess I just mean I don't feel like I'm making a statement in any kind of way. And it's fun, like what Alexei was saying, because we both, in our work life, we've talked about this, like, it is much easier for us to both very actively not at all talk about being artists and doing art. Because it's just this weird other world of, you know, there's a lot of great people too, but it's also just like dude zone to an annoying degree. And we've talked about this where it's like, it's just easier to not, you know.
Oh, what do you do for fun? I don't know.
Go on walks, have dogs, blah, blah, blah. Just not at all, like.
I'm an artist.
Like, oh, that's weird. What do you mean? What's that? Like, it's funny. It's a funny, like, other realm that we're both so, like, busy
going. I think they're also kind of just like decorative. Ornamentation.
It's on the exact opposite side from you. Yeah.
What about milk out the juice?
That's very exercise based. Like, I was thinking a lot about just like inspirational posters. Like, literally posters that would be like on the wall images. And I did, like, I've done a lot of other phrases like that, and they're usually much more muddled and concrete. That one is so legible that I almost, like, I remade the foot of that bed like 3 times. It was finally just like, yeah, you can still read it pretty well, it's okay. But they're usually much more illegible, I guess. Like, more for me. They're just kind of hidden in there just to build texture, and that one just ended up being very readable. But yeah, very much like mantras, like positivity mantras.
Are they things that you tell yourself while you're working, or have?
In a more general sense, yeah, just like positivity.
Alexa, do you tell yourself stories or spin stories out of your paintings at any point, or is the narrative on it?
There's probably, I would say, some kind of narrative going on in my mind most of the time. In the paintings,
the drawing more, like these large
last then.
Yeah, it might just be sort of session by session. I think sometimes they get a little more incorporated and sometimes you can have a more like this where it's like pilot. And maybe that's probably kind of why I started thinking about these posters.
Yeah.
Because they can start to know how they present. More like a movie poster. Then they look at movie posters.
Something about I like to hear your description of like this kind of flow of information from TV and radio and whatever YouTube media kind of filtering through your language, these lists you make, and so that then they come back out in these forms. Makes me think of like science fiction. And I had noticed when I was looking online that like there was a show you had, it was a group show. Or whether this is your title or someone else's, but it's called Meat Space. Which I think, at least the connection I draw with that is to like cyberpunk science fiction from the 80s, which was sort of the genre where the idea of a virtual world was sort of first presented, even in advance of it actually being like the internet existing, the idea of a world that exists entirely within a computer. And Meat Space was the world that was the description of how in these books that they talked about the world that we inhabit with our bodies, as opposed to the virtual world. And anyway, was that your title? Or
it wasn't, but that was not the origins of that title. No, that's really interesting. That's super cool.
So there seems like there's something, I mean, both of you, I mean, someone else mentioned, like there's something about both of your work that brings to mind a lot about bodies, like about our bodies being present in a space or a relationship that we have with objects with our bodies, like either as potential things, useful things, you know, like they interact with exercise or seats or as like the community theater poster thing again, like sort of a suggestion of like painting as an advertisement for an experience with wide bodies, you know, that there's some suggestion that this is a stand-in first pointing you towards some kind of experience in person. I guess that's not really a question, but let's see, how can I frame it as a question? I mean, I guess like whose bodies maybe is something I'm wondering, like especially with your work, Will, like there's, I mean, the saddle, the, you know, the bench, like, you know, this thing which seems to be some kind of brass knuckle-y kind of thing to grab, or anyway, like are there specific bodies that you imagine interacting with these objects, or that they're made for particular bodies, or
pretty open, just everyone, much more about like body empowerment, and it's kind of starting to move away from exercise stuff, but in general, it's much more about like feeling good, like just very personal for everyone who could interact with it, like power and just feeling well, I guess. Like I had a show up at Dakota Gallery up in Bellingham, and that one like had a good disclaimer, so everything was very like, you may touch and use this stuff. And it was pretty much all stuff that was on the floor and like hand weights and stuff like that, and that was a really fun things see because it was just wide open and people were just doing like whatever they sort of thought should be done with the stuff. And that was like sort of exactly how I think of it. Just like stretching. I mean, for like where it comes from for me is just like stretching and flexibility and sort of like feeling like a spring. Just like feeling good in a physical sense. And then just watching people sort of like, oh, there's this thing, like there's one sort of triangular thing that's I made with, like the form is made out of egg foam, so it was like a lumpy triangle, and my idea was it was like for stretching your back, like laying flat across it, and just watched a guy take off his shoes and just like stand on it, like as a foot massager, and I was like, I never thought of that, that is genius, and then just like put his shoes back on and like go with the rest of the stuff. But that's kind of the idea of just like very open-ended, like, this is like, there's shapes involved in this that are for your body, but your use of it is completely up to you.
And for pleasure, it sounds like.
Exactly. Like, it's supposed to feel good. It's not supposed to be torturous and weird. But some of it, like, tends to look good.
What's supposed to happen on that?
That one, like, yeah, even that one, it was just like posture. It's not connected to the wall, so it's like, it's probably suitable, but I would do very just like back posture, like sitting straight up and down.
Like you'd be in a saddle, of course.
Yeah.
Lexi, what about this? I guess the body question for you with your work, like, maybe it's like, like, are you when you're working, when you're making these paintings, like, and you're kind of channeling this virtual world of language, or like, are you, do you feel like you are in your body, or do you go somewhere else?
That's a question. I guess I feel sort of letting go to someplace else. Yeah, because the actual painting process sort of feels pretty automatic. So I'm able to kind of transport someplace else.
Is it a different place?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I would say that I really enjoy painting, so it's a good place.
But when you look at the way you exactly work, it's like you brought it into this space and you said, no, now I don't have those bodies to really do it.
Yeah.
And I feel like this frame is all about addressing my physical presence. It doesn't allow me to look at the drawings as just these thoughts and just this ephemeral thing. And it gives it this concreteness that it's really lovely. It's not a frame. It's not a frame you're going to take home with you. It's a frame about this spot.
And there's that cane back there that's acting as a frame on that one.
Oh, man.
So the way I felt these were actually just two pieces of work now, five. You know, that this isn't two paintings and this isn't three. That's what it was for me.
What is it for you, Alexi?
The
in
the
Is it a piece and a piece?
I think there's like literally there's just like this big bundle of these drawings and paints, and I like kind of sort of mix and match them and sort of show them together up in the but there's like a big bowl.
So I asked you guys if you have questions for each other. Is there anything you wanted to ask each other about each other's work that I think you have touched on already?
My question that I sent to you about Alexi's stuff, you kind of just tapped into, just sort of like fantasy world versus reality, and I feel like his answer about like the act of making the paintings was a pretty good answer of like their sort of coming from a separate realm. Like, do you think anything in your work is representations of reality at all? Or is it much more reimaginations of, yeah, I don't know. I feel like you kind of answered it already.
Yeah, I wouldn't say there's representations of reality. No, because, they're not like a picture and looking into a, you know, like it's not like a window, it's not like a painting or a representation of a painting, whether it's a window or a painting, it's right in front of it. There's not a lot of, pretty flat. For you, what Have you been, are you like influenced by the work you do at your work outside of your studio?
I mean, materials wise, yeah. Definitely. And just, I don't know, sort of a helpful aspect of just like, slam it together. Like, just cranking through things. So, yeah, in a way, definitely. Things go faster now.
When you're making these things and you're kind of making them sort of, you know, poorly made objects, basically, or mm-hmm. when you're trying to kind of not overthink it, or kind of trying to, is it sort of like, do you experience some sort of like, is it like a releasing or relieving feeling to kind of let go and just kind of like, oh, I'm just gonna screw some home to this thing and push it over here and mm-hmm. just toss the concrete around? Is it kind of like is that like an experience? Like, are you kind of, are you going through some kind of like a, well, not maybe emotional, but just sort of like spiritual thing doing that?
I don't know about spiritual, but it is nice, like just the ability to just use things in a stupid way. Just like use stuff in a very dumb and messy way that doesn't really make much sense.
Is it kind of like going up on stage and like performing and just act, you know?
It's more like play. It's more just like fun times. No, like nothing. There will be no problematic results, you know. But also in like knowing more about materials and like having better tools with job, it's like stuff gets too cleanly done too easily, where I'm just like, no, it should be worse. Like I've said, it came out too well to begin with. So that's been a challenge of like, I don't like how this looks. It's not fucked up enough, really. Like it's not, the skill set is growing too much. Like finding other ways of like getting to the weird, world of making good mistakes, I guess. Because like lately, especially with making stuff, we're just like, this looks like too crafty, like too like craftsman, yeah, just too cleanly done. Worst tools, I don't know.
I regularly notice you either sketching or note taking in your kind of notepad. Is the sketching and notes part of your process?
Yeah, it's one thing that I miss is riding the train, because I rode the train with my old job, so I got lots of sketching time. So I get less of that. But yeah, definitely, like there's definitely like certain forms like this I definitely drew a ton of times before I made it, and that bench that you're sitting on, I had drawn it a bunch of times in a bunch of different ways. So yeah, sort of working through just like not really how stuff will be made, but the shapes that it will be. Where sketching gets me.
And Dory, do you have a question?
Oh, I was going to say, Alexi, is it a spiritual experience with you? And if so, in a way, or if not,
yes, I think I could choose to use the word spiritual to describe it. I don't subscribe to any kind of formal or mainstream spirituality, or even any mainstream or formal or known definitions of spirituality. But I would say that I could categorize the experience of making games of spiritual gifts. I think that when you make paintings and you're really like letting go they're tapping into like a psychic world or just channeling stuff. So, and that would describe it as a ritual.
What are you channeling?
I think it's always lots of stuff. Or there's some kind of filters.
YouTube comments.
What?
YouTube comments.
You're filtering YouTube comments. I guess
it is. The world I need YouTube comments. YouTube is my
thing. Perfect. Have a good time.
You're a follower. YouTube follower. Yeah, we're done.
Thank you. Okay. Thanks you guys for being so generous with your talking about this, and thanks all
of you.
Thank you, everyone, for coming.